about myself. My career, I started as a teacher, school teacher, and I ended up as a university teacher. And in between, I worked in the curriculum development center as a, you know, course guide developer for teachers. And after doing my postgraduate diploma in education, I joined the Open University as an educational assistant. And from there, I was promoted to lecturer, senior lecturer, and then head of the Department of Early Childhood and Primary Education. So both my MPhil and PhD are in the field of early childhood education. And then I also was a visiting academic at the Brack University Institute of Educational Development, and I taught early childhood development, the course of early childhood development there. At present, I'm a member of the National Education Commission, which is the apex body, which advises the president on policy matters and also educational reforms and other matters connected to education. So that's me. Okay. Then I'll start my presentation. It's on status of early childhood care and education in Sri Lanka. Let me first give you the outline of my presentation. I will define and describe early childhood care and education, and then significance of early childhood care and education, ECC in the Sri Lankan context. I will explain the history in brief, and then current status, and also policy initiatives taken by the successive governments and challenges we face here in Sri Lanka today, and propose strategies to overcome these challenges. First, let me define the term early childhood, because different countries have given different definitions to this particular term. What is early childhood? Now, international definition for early childhood, UNESCO and WHO, it is defined as the period from conception to age 8. Why age 8? There are two reasons for assigning this age range for early childhood, from conception to age 8. Reason one is the way children learn. Children learn quite differently from children in other stages, like you see middle childhood. If you take middle childhood, children can think logically during that period, but during early childhood, until 8, their logical thinking abilities are there from 5 to 8, but they are in the in-between, where it's a transmission period, like from early childhood to the middle childhood. So in between these two ages, from 5 to 8, although they can think logically, but it's not developed much. Therefore, it is also assigned to early childhood. Then during this period, the other thing is the way they learn. They need a lot of material, equipment or things to manipulate. And also they need people to interact with. If we don't get opportunities to manipulate objects, or if you don't have opportunities to interact with people, that will hinder their development. Because that is the way they learn. Then reason two is the need to continue experiences from preconception to primary years. Children need optimum nutrition during this year, then responsive care, then they need education to develop. So if early childhood, their age range, the upper end of the age range is 5, where once you enter the formal school, nutrition and other part would be neglected. Only the education part would be, teachers focus, education authorities focus only on the education part of it. Therefore, to continue these experiences and also optimum nutrition, health and other things, responsive care and other things, early primary years are also included in the definition of early childhood. Then, however, upper age range varies in different countries. You know, according to the admission age to primary school system. For instance, in Sri Lanka, children are admitted to the primary school at the age of 5 years. Therefore, in the policy, we have defined early childhood as a period from conception to the age of school admission, which is 5 years. So this is the definition of early childhood. Then what is meant by care? Why in between early childhood and education, this particular term care, how did we come into between these two terms? Because today care is considered as a very important aspect of development. What do you mean by care? Care refers to enabling environment which supports a child's optimal development. So now if care is enabling environment, what do you mean by enabling environment? Enabling environment is an environment that emphasizes child's indoor-outdoor environments. It includes indoor environment, outdoor environment, as well as an emotional environment. Care ensures synergy of protection and support, such as health, nutrition, psychosocial, and cognitive development. So if we only use the term early childhood education, these things would be lost. Then care provides rich, varied, and safe space in setting in which children can play, explore, and learn. Care also ensures that children grow and develop to be resilient, confident, and self-assured. Care provides rich, varied, and safe space in setting in which children can play, explore, and learn. It's the same sentence, I'm sorry. Education. For education, how do we define education for children in early childhood? So ECE, early childhood education, is any type of educational program offered for children in preschool years, children, and may consist of any number of activities, experiences designed to aid in the cognitive and social development of preschoolers before they enter elementary school. So any kind of it could be any kind of program, but it should provide number of activities and experiences that designed to aid in the cognitive and social development of preschoolers. Then ECE generally encompasses kindergarten and pre-kindergarten preschools for children starting at about age 3. What is early childhood care and education? Now, when we take this whole term, we can define it as all center-based educational programs designed for educational and developmental needs of children at least 3 to 5 years of age and have staff that adequately qualified to provide educational programs for children. Now, we have defined the term early childhood care and education. And the thing is that it is the most neglected in education. It is the most neglected period because normally higher education and general education, parents as well as the authorities and the general society pay more attention on these levels of education rather than early childhood education. But if you know the benefits of early childhood care and education, if you know it properly, then you would invest more on early childhood education because it helps, it provides or develops human capital for a country. So according to brain researchers, early childhood is a crucial phase of growth and development since experiences gained during this phase influence outcomes across the entire course of an individual. According to research, 90% of the brain develops during preschool years or during early childhood years or first few years of life, I think before 5 years of age. More than one million of neural connections are formed in every second during this age range. Then after this period of rapid proliferation, connections reduce through a process called pruning. So the circuits become more efficient. Sensory pathways like those for basic vision here, first to develop during early years, followed by language skills and higher cognitive function. So there are critical periods in early childhood development. If you don't take necessary measures to provide experiences during these critical periods, it may hinder their development. For instance, human brain development. Here, neural connections for different functions develop sequentially. You can see sensory pathways, vision, hearing before 1 year. Generally, from birth to these are all months. So before a child becomes 1 year of age, these things develops. And then from first year, even before first year, they also develop language. And the critical periods are shown here. Higher cognitive function develop after, they become, after they become 1 year old. Then, of course, you need to give them experiences to develop their higher cognitive functions like imagination, creativity. There are a lot of higher cognitive functions where children need a lot of inputs from the people around him, or we call it scaffolding. So economic benefits of ECE, children enrolled in at least 1 year of preschool education are likely to develop critical skills they need to succeed in school, less likely to repeat grades or drop out of schools, and they will be more able to contribute to peaceful and prosperous and economies when they reach adulthood. So this study was done by Professor Heckman, who is an economic professor in the USA, but he has done research on early childhood education. And these are his, he has a team, their conclusion. And there, in another research, Professor Heckman has found that high quality birth to five programs for disadvantaged children, you get a 13% per year return on investment. For this, he has selected this, schools conducted for disadvantaged children. From they have taken a sample of children and done this study. And here the study, the researchers looked at participants, improved health, IQ education, that early childhood care and education decreases in their involvement in crime, and how the increased labor participation of the mothers whose children who were part of the program. All these things were considered when they did this particular study, and they have found it gives 13% per year return on investment. Then rate of return to human capital, you can see from this graph how the money invested in or finances invested in preschool programs give the rate of return much more than schooling, job training, and other levels. Then ECC in the Sri Lankan context. First, I will let me explain the history in brief, how ECCE evolved in Sri Lanka. It's a recent phenomena. ECCE, care and education, is a recent phenomena, but preschool education was first introduced in Sri Lanka in missionary schools as nurseries. Nurseries were very popular in Britain at that time. And they, in schools established by missionaries had a nursery class in their school and also churches. So and another landmark is Dr. Maria Montessori's visit. She visited Sri Lanka in 1944, and the first preschool teacher training program was started, and they were trained by Maria Montessori. And in the mid 20th century, Montessori method was of preschool education was firmly established in Sri Lanka. It was so established now any preschool regardless whether they follow Montessori method or any other method, is called a Montessori. That's a common term used for all the preschools in Sri Lanka by most of the people. A further expansion of preschools came about with education reforms introduced in 1972 when school admission raised to 6 years, because parents had to keep their children at home and they are too big to keep them at home. Therefore, government also encouraged pre-primary education and then early childhood education centers, or at that time it was called preschools, were mushroomed in every part of the country. With the devolution of powers by the 13th Amendment to the Constitution of Sri Lanka, the management and supervision of preschools were vested with the Provincial Council. To exercise this mandate, Provincial Councils has passed provincial statutes and set up provincial authorities, bureaus, units for supervision and management of preschools. In different provinces, different terminologies used. In some provinces, they have established authorities. In the eastern province, the preschool bureau is there. And in some provinces, unit is a unit established in the education ministry for preschool education. The current status, there are several types of preschools operating in Sri Lanka, and they apply different labels. Kindergarten, preschool, nursery school, then AMI preschool, then MMI preschool, and early childhood development center. But most commonly used term today is early childhood development center. Because this was proposed by the national policy on ECCD in 2004 with the aim of transforming scholastically focused preschools. Actually, what preschool did was teaching children reading and writing. To transform scholastically focused preschool into community-based child development centers that focuses on appropriate holistic development, the name was changed into Early Childhood Development Center. This term has been used by many preschools since then. And in all the government documents, the term ECD has been used instead of preschool. Then current status, according to National Census of ECD Centers conducted in 2016, that is the latest data we are having, there are nearly 20,000 ECD centers operating in Sri Lanka. Then nearly 600,000 children attend these centers. So you can see this graph, and you can see that there are 48% of 5 plus children and 37% of 4 plus children. But you can see that 3 plus children, the enrollment percentage is only 13%, and 2 plus, of course, is negligible, only 2%. But what we can see from this graph is that parents are not that interested in sending their children to preschools before, you know, they become 4 years old. That is just 1 year before entering the formal schools. Then only they become, because they want their children to perform well in school, then they start sending children to primary school, I mean pre-primary schools. Then when you take center enrollment by province, you can see Northern Province has more than 80% of children attending preschool. But of course, Central and Sabarmati Province, you can see more than 50% of children are out of pre-primary education. So the other centers also slightly more than 50%, but you know, that means a considerable percentage of children are still out of preschool. Then enrollment rates by sector. If you take the urban rural estate sectors, you can see here rural and estate sector, you can see there's a huge disparity. 67.6% of urban children attend early childhood development centers or ECC centers, and rural and estate only 47%, and 43.9 or nearly 44%. And if you take the whole enrollment rate for the whole country, there you see only 55.6% of children are in preschool. That is between 3 to 5 years. That means more than 40% of children are still not having any pre-primary education. Because the primary education is compulsory, they may be enrolling without any, you know, without being ready for schooling. Then management types, percentage distribution of is it by type of management. Here you can see 71% of preschools are conducted by private organizations and private individuals. When we say 20% of government owned preschools are there, that doesn't mean the national government. These are all municipal councils, then urban councils and other local government authorities, and also other government sector institutions that have preschools in their premises for children of their workers. And then Open University has, Columbia University also has a preschool. Then Moroto University, likewise, there are several universities that have preschools. Open University has three model preschools, you know, functioning as a practicing lab for those who follow diploma in early childhood and primary education and advanced certificate in early childhood education. For them, it serves as a practicing school. Then 3%, you can see NGOs, religious organizations, 6% are run by religious organizations and 3% by NGOs. All these preschools, almost all the preschools, you know, a majority, a huge majority, charge fees. Then infrastructure facilities, according to the census, many ECD centers lack infrastructure facilities and learning and play materials. Around 28% of ECD centers do not have drinking water. And then about 10% of ECD centers operate without any facilities. Except for swings and free play areas, a majority of centers do not have adequate outdoor equipment. Only 44.4% has climbing frames, 45.3% has sand and play area, which is very important and an essential for preschool education. Then only around 5% of ECD centers have facilities for children with special needs, ramps, handrails, and other things. Then teacher qualifications, when we take teacher qualifications, generally, according to the statute passed by provinces, basic educational qualification to be a preschool teacher is DCE O level. However, you can see that 60% of preschool teachers have passed A level, and also 3% have degree or above, and 34% have the minimum qualification. But the graph also shows that 3% of teachers don't have any, they are below GCO level. They are teaching as working as preschool teachers. And also another 3% had, the GCO level. But you can see below 3% of teachers do not have, 3% of teachers do not have any educational qualification, but they are functioning as preschool teachers. When we take professional training, you may see, this is a good sign because a majority of teachers have they have professional qualifications. 59.7% of teachers have trained for more than 2 years. And then, however, according to this graph, you can see that 4.2% of teachers don't have any training. This is what I was going to say. 7.6% had only about 3 to 6 months of training. So these two percentages are not adequate. They don't have adequate professional training to be a preschool teacher. Then what are the policies with regard to preschool education in Sri Lanka or ECCE in Sri Lanka? The first national policy on early childhood care and development was introduced by the Children's Secretariat in 2004, and it focuses on holistic development of children from conception to 5 years. This was revised in 2018, and it was approved by the Cabinet in 2019. So these are the areas for action stipulated in that policy: health and nutrition, early childhood education, child care and protection, parents, family and community, investments in ECCD. So these 5 areas, they have given strategies to implement the policy. At present, however, there is no specific policy on ECCE, that is preschool education. Last year, a policy was formulated, but it was not presented to the cabinet. Therefore, it was not approved. It's in the web, I think, in any National Education Commission web, you can find the preschool policy, but it's not approved. It is only a draft. Right now, the National Education Committee is drafting policy proposals starting from early childhood education to higher education, and they hope to submit it before the end of this year, and hopefully then of course we will have a good policy on ECCE. This is the first time we use the term ECCE for preschool education. Then challenges facing ECCE. What are the challenges we face in implementing these policies? The first one is we don't have an effective, enforceable national policy on ECCE. You can see we have ECCD policy, but not for education. Education is just a part of that ECCD policy. On the other hand, that is not a legally binding document. Therefore, they cannot, anyone who does not carry anything that is given in the policy cannot be taken, you know, cannot be punished or, you know, there is no way, because it is not a legally binding document. Therefore, we need an effective, enforceable national policy with implementing, monitoring and evaluation mechanisms, and also should be declared by the President of Democratic Socialist Republic of Sri Lanka. That is why the early policy did not take, was not implemented, because it was not declared by the president. Then inequalities in access and enrollment, that I think everyone saw from the drafts how there are inequalities in access and enrollment. There is a noticeable disparity in the enrollment rates by provinces, district, and among urban, rural, and estate. Then substandard quality of ECCE provisions. Lack of, we are yet to introduce a national curriculum framework or guidelines for early childhood care and education. Then, as a result, ECD centers are carrying out activities that are neither age nor individually appropriate. Then most ECD centers are ECCD. We call ECD centers because that's the term given by the earlier policy. Soon it will be changed into ECCE centers once the policy that is being developed by the NEC is approved. So most ECD centers are relatively weak in terms of facilitating the learning of children with special needs and materials for the development of cognitive skills. Then inadequate focus on holistic nature of ECCE. I think we all, Sri Lankans, know that parents are interested in reading and writing. So teachers do engage children in these activities rather than focusing on holistic nature. competition in achieving capabilities in reading and writing and mathematics has marginalized the concept of holistic development in the minds of both teachers and parents. Poor quality of ECCA teachers and caregivers and poor remuneration and low social recognition also affect poor quality of ECCE. For instance, our universities do not offer degree programs for ECE teachers. Then the other thing is we don't have proper in-service training programs that helps teachers to update their knowledge. Recently, the World Bank Assisted Early Childhood Development Project has developed materials, manuals, and trained trainers to conduct these in-service training classes for teachers. And it's happening all the preschool, all the areas are not covered by these in-service programs. Then ECCE teachers and support staff are usually underpaid. And also they have a very low social recognition that has made difficult to attract quality people into ECCE sector. Other challenges are inadequacies of investment, public provision, control and oversight. So the provision of ECCE services in Sri Lanka, we have to largely depend on non-state resources and incentives. The state role has mainly been regulated. Then the quality of ECCE services offered appears to be vary among different institutions. As a result, there's a considerable geographic variations in access to ECCE services, where poor, mostly rural areas deprived of the ECCE, because these are all clustered around towns and in urban areas. Then lack of enforceable legal provisions for ECCE at national and provincial level. As I told you earlier, the policy is not a legally binding document, and also we don't have an act as such to take measures for those who violate statutes passed in the provinces. So we are hoping to introduce an act. It will come, I think, near future. So some ECD centers in private schools and international schools in Sri Lanka are not. Generally, there's a rule that all the preschools should be registered in provincial councils or with the authorities set up for early childhood education. However, we find that there are number of preschools who have not registered because they are not bound by standards introduced by the provinces. The reason is these centers run as profit-making business registered under Companies Act. That is why the authorities or the ECCD units and other establishments established for to regulate ECCE cannot do anything about it. The other thing is lack of legal powers to take action against these centers and other centers operating without obtaining registration is a serious challenge faced by provincial administrative entities on ECCE. This we found from a research we conducted the government is trying to introduce one registration system for a consolidated registration system for the whole country. And we conducted the research for that. And we found interviews conducted with officers in the authorities. They said that it's impossible for them to implement their statutes because of these reasons. Then strategies to overcome challenges. I'm proposing few strategies. One is early childhood care and education should be made compulsory at least 1 year prior to school admission. Although this is proposed, the policy that is being drafted by NEC, although this is proposed here, I think it's not possible for the government to, because if you are going to make it compulsory, then you have to make it free, because you can't ask people to send their children to preschool if you don't provide free education. But therefore, I don't think in near future the government would be able to provide free preschool education or free pre-ECC education. However, the government can promote private-public partnership and philanthropic initiations to expand the access to ECC. Also, government can take measures to offer concessionary interest-free loans to providers to ECC providers to establish ECD centers in unserved and underserved provinces and areas. Government also can introduce incentives such as ECD vouchers for children of economically disadvantaged households to promote access, provide grants and other funding for early childhood programs, prioritize services to the most disadvantaged and vulnerable communities. Then the government also should implement quality standards for child development and learning. Standards have been formulated. Still, we have not implemented all over the country. So that has to be done. Then implement quality standards for ECD centers. Then introduce a curriculum framework and guidelines. That all these things are being done. In near future, this will be introduced. Facilitate universities and other institutes of higher education to design and offer programs for ECC workforce to acquire necessary professional qualifications, finance scholarship for ECC workforce and those who wish to become ECC teachers to acquire necessary qualifications with the private and non-state sector organizations. Then take necessary steps to enact legislation related to ECCE to ensure quality of the early childhood care and education system. So this is my presentation. I have come to the end of it with strategies proposed. Some of these things are being proposed by the NEC and are being formulated. So I hope you had an idea of what ECC in Sri Lanka, the current status of ECC in Sri Lanka. Thank you.